Essentially, I'm going to make changes in the volume of the system. Now, I'm going to ask the question that when I carry out this switching experiment from V1 to V2, if the change in volume happens over infinite time, that means if I pull the piston extremely slowly so that I take infinite time to change the volume of the gas from V1 to V2, then every time I do the experiment, I will get the same work. But I am going to imagine a situation where I just catch hold of the piston and move it over a finite amount of time. Now, when I do it again, I expect the work done to be different. Why it is going to be different? Because a simple way to imagine is that at the time I start that experiment, the system can be in any one of its statistical microstates. Depending upon which state it started with, the work done can be different. That is one way. Another, during the process, the system is always in contact with the heat bath. System exchanges energy with the heat bath. It gives energy to the heat bath or takes energy from the heat bath. This is happening all the time, randomly. A random process can never be reversed. If you do it very, very slowly, then at every stage the system is in equilibrium with the heat bath, and hence equilibrium work done is equal to the change in the free energy. Okay. Now I'm going to ask the question that if the time taken to carry out that switching experiment is finite and not infinity, then we have to deal with an ensemble of work values and not just one value. This statement W is greater than D, what is the meaning? When I have an ensemble of work values, let me collect all that ensemble and then they are represented by a histogram, which I call it as probability density function. So I have a row of W which describes the work ensemble that I am talking about. So let the ensemble of values of W be denoted by omega. It is quite possible that several elements of omega will be less than delta F, violating the second law. This is the second law violation that I am talking about. So let the probability distribution rho of W, I am parametrizing it by a tau, where tau is the time it takes for you to carry out that experiment. In the limit tau tending to infinity, you will find that it reduces a delta function. That is the quasi-static limit, reversible limit of tau tending to infinity. We shall have rho of W as rho of delta function of W minus. If tau is finite, then the probability of the second law violation is given by integral of this density function over minus infinity to plus infinity. That means I am going to look at the ensemble of experiment that I have done, and I am going to carefully note down the work that has been measured in each of these experiments. I am going to look at those work values which are less than the reversible work. And I am going to say that these are the scenarios in which second law is violated. One can see if tau is large but not infinity, then we can expect this ensemble rho of W to be a Gaussian, and you can have you can see for a Gaussian distribution, it has only the first two cumulants, all higher order cumulants are wrong. There is cumulants are something like equivalent to central moment about the average value. Yeah.
So why is the integral starting from minus infinity? Should not be 0 to df or?
No, work done can be positive or negative, okay, depending upon whether the system is doing the work or you are doing work on the system. So in general, you cannot have anything less than minus infinity. That's the reason. Okay. In practice, it will be from some value, minus 10, minus 100, depending upon the kind of unit. So formally, the probability of second law violation is given by this, for obvious reasons, P is called the probability of violation of the second law. But as I told you, if I calculate the average work done by saying that the minus infinity to plus infinity W rho of W dW, that average work, average W, will always be greater than the reversible work. There is absolutely no question about it. Okay? This is essentially coming from the fact that your exponential function is a convex function. It is the convexity of the exponential function that is responsible for that. But we are not talking about second law violation in that sense. We are talking about second law violation in the sense of Maxwell's theorem, which says that there are scenarios, experimental scenarios, where you have W which are less than reversible work. That is the reason why I am integrating from minus infinity to WR or delta F, where delta F is the change in free energy between the two equilibrium states. That is the state before switching, the state after switching. Okay. Our interest is to find out how P changes when tau increases. Let us figure it out if we can do some analytical work on this issue. That's I am essentially coming to the work that I have done. Let me do it.
Yeah.
I have about another 10 minutes.
Maybe 5 minutes.
Oh, sure. I'll be able to do that. So when tau increases, the distribution shall become Gaussian with smaller and smaller variance. And let us substitute the Gaussian distribution in that integral and carry out this integral. This is very, very straightforward. If you do that, carry out that integral from minus infinity to 2, WR minus average W divided by square root of 2 sigma tau, you will find that this is equal to half minus half of error function of this quantity. If you calculate it, you will find that actually this quantity increases and saturates a point, half. For large tau, we have the Callan-Belton theorem, fluctuation dissipation theorem, which tells me that the average work minus the reversible work, which we call it as a dissipation in an irreversible process, which is equal to half beta sigma square, you will recover it from the general expression. And if you substitute, that is, if you are very close to process reversibility, I can substitute this expression in the error function. I will find that P of tau is half minus half of error function of this quantity. You can see, in the limit of tau tending to infinity, this goes to zero. So the whole quantity goes to zero. I have P of tau in the limit of tau tending to infinity goes to half. This is a paradoxical result. Of course, though this result seems counterintuitive on the face of it, if you define dissipation as a random variable, W average W, there is a, dissipation is defined as an average of the work done minus the reversible work. In the limit tau tending to infinity, dissipation goes to zero as one would expect. The reason for the seemingly contradictory result, that is second law violating result, is due to the fact that when tau tends to infinity, both the dissipation and the variance of work, standard deviation goes to zero. But then sigma square is proportional to the dissipation, and hence sigma w is much, much larger. So you have a scenario where the Gaussian density collapses into a delta function in the limit of tau tending to zero. In the process of collapsing, the average Gaussian goes to zero faster than sigma goes going to zero, and hence you find that the second law violation probability increases and saturates. But this is consistent with the prediction of Maxwell in terms of them. So the moral of the story is that the Maxwell's demand cannot be won over, you cannot vanquish Maxwell's demand, and anybody who is interested, they can look at our recent work on this and note on any of the fluctuations published in the past. Thank you very much.
Questions?
In Monte Carlo simulation, how would you try to sample those systems which are violating?
No, I will simulate the system and calculate the. I will do that experiment several number of times, let us say about billion times. I have billion values of work. And then I'm going to take what is the reversible work. And I'm going to take all those values of work which is less than the reversible work. I'm going to take that fraction of that experiment, that is how many experiments have led to a value of W less than the reversible work. And that fraction is going to be the second law violation probability. I'm going to do it as a function of tau.
And then if you integrate it, it should saturate off at half.
Yes, and it does. I have not shown the results of the details of the results are in the paper, but that was not the purpose. The purpose was to show that the recent developments in terms of second law violation are not anything new, that it has been said 140 years ago by Maxwell. It's something like old wine and new bottle. That's what has been achieved. That's the take home point that I will make.
And I'd like to make a cynical comment, if you don't mind. What I feel is that in the materials or the regimes in which you are finding the second law violation are such low dimensional systems, thermodynamics fails, but Maxwell's demand becomes real.
Actually, in fact, no one has observed a second law violation on a macroscopic system.
So, but
the experimental situation that I'm talking about are done on systems on a very, very small length scales and transient time. That is, over a fraction of a microsecond, you find that the second law is right. So, it is something like thermodynamics. I would not say that thermodynamics fails. Thermodynamics is a subject which is independent.